words of power because we are kings and our words matter.
When John says God is love, he's talking about a God who's righteous. That kind of love. God who is true. That kind of love. God who is holy. He never does anything that is wrong. That kind of love. Not this kind of love. Do whatever you feel like, you know.
You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with song.
Love, according to Scripture, is not a helpless sensation of desire. No. It is not a helpless sensation of desire that you feel gushing from inside of you, where you feel all butterflies and you can't control yourself. That's not biblical idea of love. What is the biblical idea of love? It is a purposeful act of self-giving. That means the one who loves is deliberately devoted to the one who is loved. There is thought, there is will, there is determination, there is a decision, and there is a commitment. This love is thoughtful, willing, and committed. There is a commitment about this love. The love that you see out in the world does not even mention that. In fact, they don't even allow you to think. Have you ever seen some guys that will tell you, if you say, just give me some time to think, you know what they'll say? Oh, please don't think. Don't think. Just flow. Have you ever heard that? Next time you hear that, you remember me. I said it in church. They said, don't think. No, no, don't think hard. This is not something that you need to think hard about. But this is exactly the thing that's wrong with it. This is the thing that you need to think hard about. This is something that has to do with your thought, your will, your commitment, your decision. And they tell you not to use your brain. See, this is the problem, you know. God has given us brain. A lot of people think it's an unnecessary fixture in our head occupying space. And most of the time we decide not to use it, especially the more spiritual you are, the less you begin to use your brain because they think it's even a hindrance to spiritual life. One man actually told me one time when I was studying in America, one guy came over from here, he said, "Don't use this brain too much." Very spiritual man. "Don't use this brain too much, you'll be spoiled." I said, "Using the brain only, you can solve problems. God gave you brain so that you can solve your problems. You can think your way through. Human brain is something amazing, you know. You're made in the image and likeness of God. God thinks, God wills, God commits, God decides, God analyzes, God plans. We are just like God. This human brain has got all this capacity to extract information, research and find out a lot of things, gather all the information, then analyze the information gathered and project it into the future and plan and apply it in such a way that it will become advantageous to us and useful to us. No animal is able to do that. That's why you don't call your child a donkey, you know. He can't do that. Donkey can't do that. Only a human being can do that because a human being is made in the image and likeness of God, you see. Man is totally set apart from animals. There's one man who was debating another atheist guy, a scientist, on the subject of creation. So the atheist was saying man came from monkey. And this man was saying, no, man was made in the image and likeness of God, came from God. So they argued and argued and argued. And as it always ends up like, you know, there was no answer that was good enough for that atheist guy. He insisted that man came from monkey. Finally, this man said, "I'm telling you, man came from God. You're not agreeing." He says, "You came from a monkey." "I'm saying that I came from God. You're not agreeing to that. You say, I came from a monkey also. So let's close this argument and conclude this. Whatever you said is right. You came from a monkey. I came from God," he said. There is such a difference between man and animals. The thing that makes the real difference between man and animals is this enormous ability of this human mind to think and to analyze and to project into the future, plan and do things. That's why you can plan, buy a place, build a house, build your future, do things like that, because God has given you the ability to think and plan and execute things and achieve things on a great high level, you know, like nobody else can. No dog, monkey, elephant does that, you know. Most of them have bigger brains than us, you know. But they don't have bigger bodies than us. They look big and mighty, but they can't do that. We are made in the image and likeness of God, but we are blessed with this ability. But the worldly kind of love always promotes feeling and emotion at the expense of thoughts, will, decision, commitment, and all of that. It puts it aside and lays the emphasis upon feeling and emotion. 1 Corinthians 14, love suffers long. That's God's love. It's kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It's not puffed up. Does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. Certainly, this cannot flow involuntarily from a person, this kind of love. You see the point now. This cannot just be an emotion. This cannot just be a feeling. This cannot flow without you knowing it. You can't say, I fell into this kind of love. No. You can't say, without me knowing, I'm suffering long and I'm kind. I don't envy, I don't parade myself. And I'm not puffed up and all. These descriptions, as soon as you read them, you can see that this love is not something that can happen without you knowing it, without you really exercising it. It is not something that can happen involuntarily. It cannot happen on a feelings or emotional level. Feelings and emotions can accompany it later, but it has to happen on a thought level. It has to happen on a will level. It has to happen on a commitment level. There has to be this element of choice, volition, decision. These things are necessary for this love. Otherwise, this love is not possible at all. You got to decide to be like that. You got to choose to do this. You have to decide and determine that this is what you're going to be. It's not just going to happen. You got to give thought to it. You got to think about it. I think you are able to see that immediately. This is totally different from what the world describes as love. They say it's feeling, it's emotion, it's a goosebump. It is some kind of an involuntary kind of thing. You just fall into it. You are just taken, swayed by it. You don't even know what's happening, but it's happening to you. No, this love cannot be like that. You can see it as soon as you read it. It becomes very clearly evident. So, in what sense is it true that God is love? Now, let's really interpret it. What does it mean to say God is love? In what sense is it true? Many people misinterpret it. They understand it wrongly or misunderstand it, and sometimes I think they deliberately do that. When it says God is love, some people take it this way. They say God is love means love is God. So what happens is, when you interpret it like that, it sounds reasonable because it says God is love. If God is love, then love must be God. That's how they reason. And if love is God, then love is not, then God is not a person. If love is God, then God is not a person. They depersonalize God. They kind of tell you that God is not a person. God is a force. One fellow said he's a cosmic energy. Sounds nice, isn't it? There's nobody. You can't expect God to be a person. God, you feel butterfly inside of you. You feel that goosebump. You feel that emotion, that feeling. That's God. Why? Because God is love. If God is love, then love is God. Then if love is God, then God is not a person. It's just a feeling. It's a cosmic energy. God is just a sensation that you feel. A lot of cultish people believe like this. Christians must be aware of this. Sometimes Christians are taken in, along with this, taken by this idea. They say, yeah, if God is love, then love is God. Wrong. God is love, but love is not God. God is a person, just like you and I are persons, except he doesn't have a body, but he has everything else. He has the ability to think. He has the ability to will. He has the ability to choose. He has the ability to analyze. He has the ability to determine, plan, feel. God is capable of all this, and that is why you and I are capable of all this. Right? God is a person. God is a spirit, but he is a person. Just like you and I are a person, because he has intellect, will, emotions, everything he's got that we've got as a person. So when John says that God is love, he didn't mean that love is God and therefore God is not a person. That's not the sense in which you should understand it. When John says God is love, he meant that if you want to describe God, God is love is the highest expression of his person. This person, how can he be best described? The best way to describe God The highest way to describe God is to describe Him as love. What is God like? God is love. God is love is the highest way or highest expression of His person. God is a person. You must never lose sight of it. All right. Secondly, let's deal with it one by one. Secondly, this verse which says God is love by no means identifies God with everything our society labels as love. Our society labels all kinds of things as love. But this verse is not saying that God is that kind of love. Our society calls all kinds of things love. You know, they love pizza. Some people love their cat. Some people love their dogs. You know, they love all kinds of things. So the society labels all kinds of things as love. But really, seriously, even worse than that, a lot of people who do sinful things love this verse. 1 John 4:8 is loved by them. Because they take this verse where it says God is love and they use it to provide excuse for their sinful actions. I used to know a guy who was a musician. He just drank his way to death, you know. Good fellow, but he drinks and drinks and drinks. Christian. I tried to reform him and I tried to take him, do all kinds of things, but nothing could help him, you know. He would just drink and drink and drink. And when he drinks, he will argue with me. He say, didn't Jesus turn water into wine? He'll start preaching to me, you know. Didn't Paul say to Timothy, have a little wine for your stomach's sake? For your stomach's sake? I'm also feeling something in my stomach. That's why I had a little bit. But his wine was not for his stomach ache. The stomach ache came because of the too much drinking. It's the other way around. He drinks in the morning, he drinks in the afternoon, he drinks at night, and he's filling himself with this junk, you know. And not only stomach, everything else is burnt out, you know, totally. And he died of it. So you can see that is how it didn't really help him, you know. So a lot of people are like the drunk, you know, who uses Bible verses for their sins, to promote their sins, to give excuse for their sins. So they take this 1 John 4:8 and they say, God is love. And you know how they apply it? They tell the other person that they want to sin with, they say, do you feel it? Do you feel it bubbling? Gushing? Do you feel that stuff that I'm feeling? You know what? God has given us that. Because the Bible says God is love. That's divine. What you're feeling right now is divine. Go with it. Flow with it. Don't think. No, no, no. No thinking. Thinking will ruin this. You'll decide otherwise. Don't think. Just flow with it. Because this is divine. How I know it's divine? 1 John 4:8 says, God is love. So if you're feeling love, the feeling love is not the Bible love. He's talking about the feeling love. If you're feeling love, if you're feeling the emotion, you're feeling the butterfly, you're feeling like someone is sweeping you off your feet, that's God. Because God is love. Go with God. So what we do now is divine. Hello? I have actually met people who use things like this, who use excuses like that. They talk like this. After all, God is... See, the other day I mentioned how one man used to tell me, you should not taste the food, you should just swallow it so that you can be strengthened by it. Tasting is worldly, you know. But God is good. He has given us taste buds. He didn't give it as a tongue, as a thing you to lap up food and fill our stomach, but He has given it as a... He has given it that extra thing to taste the food and enjoy the food. Not just swallow the food, but enjoy the food because God is good. But did God give that? Yes. Are you supposed to enjoy your food? Yes. Right? You thank God, enjoy your food. But it doesn't mean that on your way home, you look at another man's mango hanging on the tree and say, oh, that looks lovely, and my tongue is, you know, wanting it, so I'm going to take it. No. And you can't look at somebody's garden and say, look at that brinjal, my goodness. Looks like the good Bangalore kind. Let's take a few of them to our house, you know. Now, as you're walking down the street, you cannot go rob everybody's garden and get into everybody's kitchen and eat their chicken and go. That will be illegal. That is not why God gave you the taste buds. You are to legitimately enjoy this pleasure that God has given to you. You need to go to the market. Hello? And spend your money. Get the mutton and chicken and whatever you want and the mangoes and the vegetables, bring it home and make it the way you like and eat all you want. There is nothing wrong with it. You can't just take anything that you want out there and do it any way you like. It just can't. That's illegal. Don't use that as, what to do, brother? My tongue, you know, it's watering when I saw your mango. So I had to take a half a dozen home because my wife also likes it. One of these days, you're going to get it good, you know, if you do that. Nobody does that. They understand that's illegal. That's not right. Indecent. Right? So yes, God has given us these pleasures and all of that, you know, including the ability to taste food and all that, but it must be experienced legitimately in a legitimate manner. See? But these people use this, 1 John 4:8, they say, God is love. So if you're feeling love, if you're feeling that you're coming off your feet and losing your mind and going crazy, that's God you're feeling. You're full of God. So use it. Flow with it. That's a wrong interpretation of God is love. And John said God is love. He was not speaking about that kind of a feeling, that sweeping emotion that destabilizes you and causes you to do things in an indecent manner. No. When John said God is love, you know what he's talking about? He speaks of a pure, holy love, consistent with all other attributes of God, such as his holiness, his justice, his righteousness, his truth, and all these things. God is all these things. So when you say God is love, when John says God is love, he's talking about a God who's righteous, that kind of love. God who is true, that kind of love. God who is holy, he never does anything that is wrong. That kind of love, not this kind of love. Do whatever you feel like, you know. Thirdly, we're getting there. We're trying to see what it means. In what sense is it true to say that God is love? People say all kinds of things about this. Thirdly, God is love is not meant to be a definition of God or a summary of his attributes. That phrase is never meant to be a definition of God or a summary of his attributes. In other words, let me say it clearly. In other words, you can't say that when you say God is love, that's enough. He's nothing else. He's just love. You can cancel out everything. You can put away everything. If you say God is love, that contains everything else. This one description is enough. And it contains within it everything about God. That is wrong. This was never meant to be a definition of God. This was never meant to be a summary of his attributes. Because his attributes are many. His attributes is not just love. His attributes are many. So you should not say God is only love. If you say God is love, that covers everything. Nothing else is necessary. You don't need to know about anything. That's wrong. God has other attributes. For example, he's omniscient. That means he's all-knowing. Omnipresent. It is all present everywhere. Omnipotent, he's all powerful, right? He's immutable, that means he's unchanging. He's holy, that means Sin has nothing to do with him. He has nothing to do with sin. He's righteous. That means he's always right. Everything that he does is right. He's just. He's a just God. He's like a judge. Turns a blind eye to everything else. Just does what is right. That's what a judge does. He's a judge. So all these descriptions are there in the Bible about God.
This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year. Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing, shout, and praise the Lord. This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing and shout and praise the Lord. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Sing that again. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. This is the season of Jubilee.